Most of the world knows him as the Irish saint who banished the snakes. But he wasn't Irish, and there were no snakes in Ireland. The true story of St. Patrick is of a fugitive slave running for his life. A visionary mystic. A radical priest fighting for his mission. An outcast beloved by a nation. In his wake, two worlds collide, and one is transformed forever.
Patrick, a sinner, the least of all the faithful and utterly despised by many. Although I am imperfect in many things, I nevertheless wish that my brethren and kinsmen should know what sort of person I am.
His story begins not in Ireland, but in Britain, at the westernmost edge of the Roman Empire. Patrick was born in the town of Banavem at the close of the 4th century.
He was by culture a Roman, and that meant that he was a product of a highly organized civilization, the most organized civilization in ancient times.
Patrick was the son of a Roman nobleman, so he grew up in a household of wealth. He would have been waited on, and he would have seen that as a very normal form of life.
It was a way of life that would not endure. Christianity had become the empire's official religion, but Patrick was one of many who strayed.
We turned away from God. And did not keep his commandments, and did not obey our priests.
He didn't practice, he said. We didn't listen to our clergy, who warned us about our salvation.
The walls of Banavem could not protect Patrick from the forces that lurked beyond. His life of ease and comfort would come to an end in a brutal twist of fate.
It was violent and merciless and quick. They just dashed in, killed many of the servants, and took the ones they thought would be valuable. They didn't kill those, and they dumped them into the boats.
At the age of 16, Patrick was kidnapped by the most fearsome barbarians of their day, Irish slave traders.
The Irish raiders were professionals. They were out to make money, to kidnap slaves and to sell them back in Ireland.
For Patrick and the others taken that day, the voyage west was like falling off the edge of the earth. Protected by a treacherous sea, Ireland had never been conquered by mighty Rome. Its sheer cliffs kept at bay all but the most fearless pirates and slave traders.
They knew the route along the southern coast and up into the west coast of Ireland. And then what they did was they sold the slaves all along the coastline to people who were interested in buying them.
Patrick knew his fate. Nobody escaped from Ireland. Nobody ever made it back to Britain.
He thought he'd never again see home. Everything was gone. Now he was a slave.
The Irish were a fighting people. They were always fighting. There was no united Ireland. There was a high king who paid the attention to him beyond 10 miles beyond his palace. They never did. They still don't.
We know from Irish stories that they engaged in headhunting, that they prized bravery and fierceness in battle.
The more heads you could cut off as a warrior, the better. The soul was believed to be contained within the head. So to take the head of your enemy was literally to almost take their soul.
The Lord brought over us the wrath of his anger and scattered us among the many nations, even unto the utmost part of the earth, where now my littleness is placed among strangers.
Patrick's savage captors sold him to the chieftain of a remote Irish realm.
One can only guess at the shocking transformation it must have been from a well-organized, reasonably quiet life to something that bore no resemblance at all to anything that he had been used to. This is what is the measure of the man. Many a human being would have collapsed, psychologically collapsed, just to cast off in the lowest strata of society. Patrick didn't. Patrick survives.
But his life as a slave and outcast had just begun. Darker days lay ahead. Patrick's master sent his miserable young slave to the mountains to tend his flock. The stony pasture became Patrick's prison, the sheep his only companions.
He was terribly lonely and despairing and totally helpless, stripped down.
As the months turned into years, Patrick lost all hope of ever going home again. He faced his hunger and his terror alone.
The amazing thing is how he survived it all. But it's perfectly clear that he was thrown back on the only stable and powerful influence in his life, which was his Christian religion. He turned to his Christian God.
I would pray constantly through snow, frost, rain.
He says he would pray up to 100 times a day and as often again during the night.
Something happens to you when you're alone like that. You develop such a relationship with nature and nature's clouds and movement and the mystical Irish landscape. It has a huge effect on you.
The love of God and his fear came to me more and more. And my faith was strengthened.
It was what we now call a conversion. And religious conversions can be very powerful things. We don't have to quote Paul on the road to Damascus.
In no case, Moses, Paul, Patrick, did this conversion come about as an act of choice. it is forcefully done to the converted man.
Before I was humbled, I was like a stone lying in deep mud. But he that is mighty came and in his mercy raised me aloft.
It was in the midst of prayer that Patrick's transformation began.
I heard a voice saying to me, "It is well that you fast. Soon you will go to your own country."
"Soon you will go to your own country." How could he go to his own country as a slave? How could he get out of Ireland? Where would he go?
And again, after a short while, I heard a voice saying to me, "Behold, your ship awaits you." It was not near, but a distance of perhaps 200 miles. I had never been there, nor did I know a living soul there.
Patrick knew that the Irish put runaway slaves to death. Nevertheless, he began his escape.
I took flight and left those with whom I had stayed for 6 years.
A slave who escapes is actually breaking the law, and anybody who provides him with any kind of protection in the process is also in breach of the law.
It was an awesome journey. He was coming from the northwestern part of Ireland, and he had to journey across the entire island. He had to avoid any sorts of settlements. He may have traveled at night, anything to avoid attention.
I went in the strength of God, who directed my way to my good, and I feared nothing.
He had learned to trust in God in a way that's unimaginable to most people.
His trust was well placed, for at last, Patrick found the ship the voice had promised.
Patrick says that he wasn't afraid until the very end of it, when he came to a ship, because this was the real moment of truth. He had to reveal himself as a runaway Irish slave.
Patrick approached the ship's crew as they prepared to set sail. He begged them to take him aboard.
The ship captain wasn't going to have him. But he doesn't give up because he's had this dream. It says you're going to get home.
I left them, and as I went, I began to pray. And before I had ended my prayer, I heard one of them shouting behind me, "Come, hurry. We shall take you on in good faith." I believe that his spirit even then was crying out in my behalf. And so it came to pass, and we set sail at once.
The voice had led Patrick out of slavery, and now it was bringing him home.
And it's the fulfillment of that promise in a dream that sets him on the way. Something big is happening to this person.
At the dawn of the 5th century, after 6 years of bondage, Patrick found his way home to Banavim.
Nobody had ever escaped from Ireland. It was like somebody returning from the land of the dead.
The whole town celebrated Patrick's return.
You think you're never going to see him again. That's it. So, can you imagine the huge joy when he returns home?
At last, I was in Britain, with my people, who received me as their son.
But Patrick's joy was short-lived. Roman Britain no longer felt like home.
Even after his return to civilization and his life of relative, at least, ease, the Irish kept bugging Patrick. They just didn't get out of his mind. Because in their midst, in spite of all that he had endured among them, he had found what was to be the overwhelming power of his entire life.
As he recovered from his enslavement and escape, Patrick heard the voice again. One night, in a vision, an Irishman came to him and handed him a scroll.
I read the opening words of the letter, which were, "The voice of the Irish." But at the same moment, I heard voices from the Western Sea cry out, "We ask thee, holy boy, come and walk among us once more."
The voice of the Irish. Come back to us. He knew the import of that. He knew that he was being called back.
I was broken in heart. Why I should ever return to the people from whom once before I barely escaped.
And it took him time to really get resigned to the idea. The voice of God was speaking again.
He saw himself as directed by the Lord God Almighty. Get back to these people and offer them what he had and they hadn't.
To preach among the Irish, Patrick knew he must first make up for the years of schooling his enslavement had cost him. He donned clerical robes and trained for the priesthood. But his lack of learning haunted him.
I had in mind to write, but hesitated until now, afraid of exposing myself. I had not studied like the others, who had thoroughly imbibed law and sacred scripture.
He doesn't have the formal training in rhetoric, and he knows, he starts off by telling us that, and that he's almost embarrassed by his lack of learning.
His insecurity isolated him, and his resolve to evangelize among the pagan Irish set him at odds with his superiors.
This was the first time anybody had even contemplated bringing these savages, as the word in modern English it corresponds to barbarian, into the Christian fold.
Many tried to prevent my mission. They would say, "Why does this fellow want to throw himself into danger among enemies who have no knowledge of God?"
But Patrick's will was unshakable. After decades of struggle, he proceeded from deacon to priest. At last, a skeptical church made him a bishop and allowed him to return to Ireland.
And the bishops weren't a bit keen on this. But they did realize and see that Patrick was being led by the Spirit.
The few Christians who had ventured into Ireland before Patrick fled in the face of violence and scorn.
you definitely know that this guy has had an extraordinary experience of God. And that's what drives him on. It gives him the courage to go on his mission.
He was the first person ever to contemplate evangelizing a whole nation. And that was a very imaginative, radical, revolutionary departure.
I did not go to Ireland of my own accord. The Lord made me fit that I should care and labor for the salvation of others.
Standing for the last time on Britain's coast, Patrick gazed into an uncertain future. In the year 432, Patrick sailed back to the land of his captivity to embark on a mission no one else thought possible.
99.9% of human beings go with the flow. And it's only here and there in history that somebody emerges right against the current, faces a completely new world, and finds the resources to do it.
It was unheard of for anybody to step outside the Roman Empire and preach the gospel. They didn't even preach it within the Roman Empire, except in the cities.
You don't send out an individual, you don't even send out a group of individuals to a pagan place where Christianity has never been seen before. It's too dangerous. You'll be parted from your head pretty rapidly, and Patrick himself realized that.
I must make this choice, regardless of danger. I must make known the gift of God without fear.
Patrick returned to a pagan world of strife and peril. Few men could traverse Ireland alone and unprotected and hope to survive.
Can you imagine somebody who's been in bondage wanting to go back to convert the owners, his former masters? This is the big mystery about Patrick. What brought him back to Ireland? You'd think he would have had his fill of it, but back he went.
Greedy kings and warring tribes had carved the land into a multitude of fiefdoms. What saved Patrick's life was his generosity and the language he had learned as a slave.
Bishop Horick, we'll gather him on current show from earth.
He knew how things worked. He knew that it was a society of gift giving. He would have brought something valuable in order for the king to give at least his protection.
So he knew that he would have to get in with the king before he'd be accepted. He wasn't more than minding sheep and cattle and all the rest of it. He learned the lie of the land.
Having obtained safe passage, it now fell to Patrick to persuade the Irish to give up their traditional beliefs. Their ancient gods and goddesses embodied the elemental forces of nature. They were all-powerful and had held sway over the Irish for more than 1,000 years.
The Irish had never even thought about the idea of a single deity before. So that was his first hurdle, to say to the Irish people that there really is a God.
And he knew that if he was going to present this new faith, it had to be presented in ways that would be acceptable to the people he was trying to bring on board.
The landscape teemed with the spirits of Celtic deities, imbuing Ireland's rivers and lakes with special magic.
Water is always seen in our folklore as threshold place. The river is the place between this world and the other world. It's an in-between place. It's a place where you meet the fairy world.
When Patrick led the Irish to their rivers to meet his God, they followed, for water to them was sacred.
he has learned how to insinuate new ideas into an existing structure.
He did not scorn their traditions, but merged them into his own faith. He introduced the Irish to a loving and merciful God, and to the ideal of selflessness through the stories he told about Jesus.
He must have done a good job of presenting Jesus, this man who wandered around, was crucified. They must have liked that. They must have been intrigued by the idea of somebody sacrificing himself. And there was Patrick sacrificing himself.
I have set thee as a light unto the utmost part of the earth. It is there that I wish to spend my life.
Patrick set out to provide his newfound countrymen with the precious gift of literacy.
This will be my glory. For a wise son, the glory of his father.
He must have been a hell of a teacher. I think he was good humored. You had to be good humored, otherwise you wouldn't get by in Ireland. If you go to Ireland all pompous and solemn-faced, they'll quickly tell you go and sit in the corner. They refuse that man a pint.
To spread the word of God, Patrick preached to the Irish not as the church had taught him, but as the Irish demanded.
He's unique in the history of the church. Not alone did he leave the Roman Empire to preach the gospel, but he preached the gospel not in Latin, but in good Mayo Irish. Because the Irish people didn't give two hoots about Latin or the Roman Empire. They knew their own language and their own culture, and they were very proud of it. And if Patrick couldn't speak to them in their own language, day-day.
And he must have been very eloquent and persuasive. Patrick converted practically a whole nation in an Ireland that at that time was not friendly to strangers.
This success which he enjoyed in Ireland prompted some jealousy among the churchmen of Britain. He was being observed.
Somebody is finding fault with him all the time, either because of the little things he's doing, or maybe even bigger still, there are those who say he shouldn't be there at all.
Little did Patrick know that in his triumph lay the seeds of his greatest crisis.
Rather than rejoicing in the good effect that a whole new world was being introduced to Christianity, these people were simply interested in destroying the mission.
There was a tribunal of inquiry set up. There were complaints made against him.
The bishop summoned Patrick back to Britain to face their charges as if he were a criminal. The most shocking accusation came from his closest friend.
His best friend stood up and told a sin that Patrick had committed as a young boy.
Though Patrick never recorded his boyhood sin, some still wonder if it was debauchery, thievery, or worse.
We know that it troubled his conscience severely, and he felt the need to confess it.
The man to whom Patrick confessed had once been his staunchest supporter.
Now that man was bound never to repeat that. And the awful thing was that this man came out and told this sin before the whole tribunal.
To him I had confided my very soul. He let me down before all.
This sin was used as a pretense by the bishops of Britain to try to get him kicked out of Ireland.
When I was accused on that day, Was I struck so that I might have fallen now and for eternity?
Here are his people degrading him. It was a big shock.
And Patrick was crushed under the heel, as he said.
He sank into such a depth of despair and depression that he didn't think that he was ever going to get out of it.
He nearly lost the faith.
Never permit it to happen to me that I should lose his people in the utmost parts of the world. I pray to God to give me perseverance. Very angry that my chosen one has been criticized. The voice didn't say, "You are angry," but "We are angry," as if God were speaking for both of us.
The voice that had led him out of bondage now restored to him his renegade spirit. In a personal testament to his life and mission, he flatly refused the bishop's summons.
Bishop Horik, Haki.
I am Patrick, a sinner, most unlearned, the least of all the faithful and utterly despised.
Declaring his innocence, Patrick told the story of his life in language that was direct and heartfelt.
Let those who will laugh and scorn. I shall not be silent.
He had character. He wasn't going to be put down by anything. Nothing put down Patrick.
I cannot hide God's gift, which he bestowed upon me in the land of my captivity.
Through his story, he offered a song in praise of God and his creation.
There I sought him, and there I found him, and he saved me from all evil.
His mission is driven by his faith experience, and they don't get that, and they ought to get that if they're men of faith.
You men of letters, listen and pore over this. Who was it that roused me up, the fool that I am? He inspired me, the outcast of this world, to faithfully serve the people for the duration of my life. This is my confession before I die.
Shaken by the force of his testament, the bishops backed down. For the rest of his life, Patrick of Ireland continued to minister to his adopted people. And the Irish rewarded him with their love. At the time of Patrick's death in the mid-5th century, Western Europe was in chaos. The Roman Empire was burning at the hands of barbarians. The Dark Ages were about to descend upon all of Europe. But the Irish church Patrick founded continued to flourish. All over Ireland, his followers raised stone crosses 3 men high, announcing the success of the new faith. They were not gravestones, but illustrations of biblical stories that even the illiterate could understand. Ireland became the principal center of not only piety, but of knowledge. During the Dark Ages, literacy survived only in monasteries, and the Irish clergy became the luminaries of the Western world.
People came in from Europe and in from Britain and came in. There were thousands of people coming to school here in the after Patrick's time.
Fugitive scholars from all over Europe saved ancient texts from the barbarians and smuggled them into Ireland. They turned its monasteries into the storehouses of the great works of Western literature and the birthplace of a new Europe.
The Irish invented European civilization. And while they're doing it, they do a number of other extraordinary things. Invent everything that you and I take for granted on a printed page.
They were the first to separate words, one from the other. Up to that, words were all stuck together. The Irish separated words.
And they developed ideas like paragraphs and the difference between uppercase and lowercase, and it was just this huge explosion of creative activity.
Irish monks copied and illuminated the classical works of Western civilization. The most glorious of these manuscripts, the Book of Kells, depicts the four Gospels. The monks who created it included whimsical allusions to monastic life, along with their own caricatured self-portraits. These pages honor their warmth and humanity and their playful sense of humor. The Book of Kells intertwines Christian and Celtic imagery, uniting Patrick's Ireland with its pre-Christian past. This celebration of what was beautiful in both cultures is a testament to Patrick's genius, which brought the two together in a loving embrace.
7th century legend produced a Patrick, which is really the Patrick that most of us know.
Well, the church is trying to make him a standard bishop by dressing him up with mitre and scepter, more or less as a standard continental style Orthodox bishop would be.
An ambitious Irish church seized Patrick's legacy. They circulated among the faithful fables and miracles chronicled by Murahu, Patrick's first official biographer. One of the most famous legends describes Patrick's triumph atop the Hill of Slain, where he lit the first Easter fire on a sacred pagan holiday. When the furious king retaliated, Patrick made himself and his retinue disappear.
They weren't trying to be deceptive and trying to make up imaginary stories about Patrick, but Patrick to them was a hero, and they wanted their hero to have the same quality as all of the other great Christian saints and be able to work miracles and to do wonderful things.
Saint Patrick was said to have chased all the snakes out of Ireland. And though he did rid Ireland of the serpentine spirit of paganism, there had not been a snake in Ireland since the Ice Age. Irish folklore married the familiar three-leafed shamrock to Patrick's tale. Legend claims he used this sacred plant of the Druids to explain the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
We don't have any good evidence that Patrick ever used a shamrock in his explanations of the Trinity. He might have, but we just don't know.
But Patrick's life was legend and miracle enough. He electrified people with his teachings. And he still inspires thousands to journey across Ireland to pay him homage. Down Cathedral in County Down claims to be Patrick's final resting place. But so does Saul, where Patrick is said to have founded his first church. Crowpatrick in County Mayo marks the spot where legend claims Patrick spent 40 days and nights communing with God and banishing the demons. For hundreds of years, pilgrims have climbed the mountain as an act of penance. On the last Sunday in July, thousands still ascend the mountain to honor Ireland's most famous saint.
I suppose wherever the Irish went, they brought him with them, this figure of St. Patrick. And I assume that the great St. Patrick's Day parade on the 17th of March is a direct descendant of that.
The first St. Patrick's Day parade was organized by homesick Irish immigrants in America. Over 200 years ago, on the traditional anniversary of St. Patrick's death, Irish soldiers in the colonial army marched through the streets of New York to pay Patrick loving and joyful tribute. Today, on March 17th, in cities around the world, more than 50 million people gather. Both Irish and not, they celebrate St. Patrick with annual parades and festivities he could never have imagined.
If Patrick were to come back, and somebody were to say, I have a little balcony here on Fifth Avenue, I want to see this parade, he'd jump off the balcony and say, stop! This is not what I was preaching at all. Now disperse, go home and pray, and help the poor.
What is striking about Patrick is that he is the only citizen of the Roman Empire to have been taken captive, to have been taken away from kith and kin, from home and hearth, to have lived in that place for 6 years. Escaped from it, to have written his experiences, and for those experiences to have survived. There's nothing like it anywhere in the world, not just in terms of Irish history. This guy is absolutely exceptional.
So we have seen it. And so it has been fulfilled. However ignorant I was, I dared to preach his gospel for a testimony to all nations. I pray whosoever deigns to look at this writing, which Patrick, the sinner, has composed in Ireland, let this be your conclusion. It was the gift of God.